بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Again we return to the chapter 2 of the path of worshippers, منهاج العابدين. And it is about repentance. عند إمام الغزالي is inviting the worshipper, the seeker of worship, to repent for two purposes, so that he or she, of course, could basically find the sweetness of worship. Without repentance, one's sins will prevent her from reaching that level where they could enjoy really worship. And I would like to say about the joy of worship. I was once invited to address high school students in a school that caters to Palestinian kids who were born in the United States, raised in the United States, or simply for whatever reason, they ended up in this school, so the medium instruction is still English. So the American cultural background is predominant. This background is important because one of the kids asked me a question, but I have to mention what I was talking about. I was talking about the angels, about at one moment in my talk, I spoke about the angels, and I did say that the angels worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tirelessly, and they absolutely obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لا يعصون الله ما أمرهم. One of those youngsters asked me, but what do they do for fun? They asked about the angels. What do they do for fun? وكأن سؤال الطلبة كان عن ماذا تفعل الملائكة من أجل المتعة؟ عبادة وطاعة فيهم. طب شو بسوي للمتعة؟ Worship is fun. Worship is fun. Worship is sweet. Those who find sweetness, they will continue one form of worship after the other without negating or basically ignoring their other duties, taking care of themselves, of their families, of their societies. Imam al-Ghazali, we did say this, but as a summary, he made sure that we understand if we suffer from sins on our record without repentance, and our tongues had a share almost of every single ill of the tongue, how could this person be invited by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to recollect, to mention the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in ذكر. الإمام الغزالي says that if you happen to be in such a position, you are shackled. مكبول، مكبل. Then Imam al-Ghazali spoke about the necessity of repentance as a prerequisite. As a prerequisite. And he gave an example using debt. Rather than giving a gift to your creditor, because in Arabic he said, رب الدين. And I initially read this as رب الدين. And the translator translated رب الدين, the Lord of religion. No. The example is about your creditor. You owe $100,000, for example, to someone, and it's time to pay your debt. It's due. And you send a gift that is worth $10. You should pay your debt. Repent. That's a debt. You need to every day. How about basically every day, every night? Start the day with repentance for things that you have done during the night. And end the day with repentance for things that you have done during the day. The Prophet ﷺ in one session used to make istighfar in one hadith 70 times, another hadith 100 times. And you know very well. The prophets do not commit sins. They might do what is usually described as khilaf al-awla, the second best, translating liberally, but it would not be a sin per se. So how could you basically use your tongue to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he's angry with you, about you, because of all the sins that you continue to commit? Yes? La ilaha illallah. فهذا ظاهر حال العصاة المصرين على المعصية والله المستعان. فإن قلت فما معنى التوبة النصوح وحدها وما ينبغي للعبد أن يفعله حتى يخرج من ذنوب كلها؟ الحد التعريف but let us read the whole thing again. والثاني من الأمرين إنما تلزمك التوبة لتقبل منك عبادتك، فإن رب الدين لا يقبل الهدية، وذلك أن التوبة عن المعاصي وإرضاء الخصوم فرض لازم. وعامة العبادة التي تقصدها نفل، فكيف يقبل منك تبرعك والدين عليك حال؟ حل موعد ايش؟ سداد الدين. لم تقضه، وكيف تترك لاجله الحلال والمباح وانت مصر على فعل المحظور والحرام؟ وكيف تناجيه وتدعوه وتثني عليه وهو العياذ بالله عليك غضبان؟ فهذا ظاهر حال عصاة المصرين على المعصية والله المستعان. فان قلت فما معنى التوبة النصوح وحدها وينبغي للعبد ان يفعله حتى يخرج من الذنوب كلها؟ The second concern states repentance. Or that states repentance is to have your worship accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your creditor, but it could be the Lord of religion does not accept gifts, for repentance from sin is a debt to God and an essential obligation. قضاء الدين الذي عليك فرض. The other types of prayers you perform are supererogatory, meaning nafila, you don't have to. Any act I think for supererogation, supererogatory acts, ويؤثرون على أنفسهم ولو كان بهم خصاصة. So you do need something and then you give it away as charity. That's ithar and that's supererogatory act. When you sacrifice yourself, when you don't have to, except on a very, very high moral grounds. An aeroplane fell into the it was a very cold weather, probably because of ice sheets on the wings or something. So the moment it took off from Reagan Airport in Washington DC, it fell into the Potomac River. It was extremely cold, and a young man, because there were survivors, he kept swimming, saving people. And he would go back again. He died out because of hypothermia. So he sacrificed himself. At any rate, therefore, how will supererogatory prayers be accepted while you do not perform the obligatory ones? Imam al-Ghazali says, if praying at night, nafila, prevents you from praying fajr during its proper time, then don't pray nafila. Some people might stay up during the night. Praying just before fajr, they would sleep. Pray your obligatory prayers first. أدومها. How could you abandon that which is permitted or that which is neither forbidden nor recommended while you persist in that which is prohibited? How could you perform supplications and invoke God while he is angry with you? May he be our refuge. This is a description of the state of the rebellious man who persists in committing sins. God is the helper when he is asked. Wallahu al-musta'an. Wallahu al-musta'an. If it is said, this is a theoretical question that Imam al-Ghazali asked, but it's very important. What are the boundaries of sincere and pure repentance? Boundaries, yes, the definition of sincerity. Tawbah nasuh, pure. And what must a servant of God do to be relieved of all sins? Here Imam al-Ghazali says, فأقول أما التوبة فإنها سعي من مساعي القلب وهي عند التحصيل في قول العلماء رضي الله عنهم تنزيه القلب عن الذنب. I shall say to you that repentance is one of the struggles of the heart and according to scholars of religion, scholars of religion. May God be pleased with them, once attained, facilitates purifying the heart from sins. Stay away from sins. I'm going to say it in a very simple fashion, and I hope that I will basically be a follower of what I'm saying, how difficult it is to fulfill your obligation and to stay, to live in the domain, the circle, the area of that which is halal. Stay away from haram. How difficult is that? How difficult is that? In fact, the area of halal, the area of halal is always, always, in every respect, dominant, plentiful. They say, okay, let's basically give an example. Alcohol is haram. Orange juice is halal. Carrot juice is halal. Water, of course, needless to say. I'm going to say 1,001 kinds of juice, and it's only a metaphor. In fact, you can mix things. You can mix things, and you can make them 1,000,001 halal drinks. Food, dead animals, pork, and few things that are haram for us. But the halal is plentiful. In every respect, the halal is plentiful. Why gamble? It's haram. You can work as a teacher, you can work as a physician, you can work as a driver, you can work as, again, 1,001 professions that are halal. Repentance. Staying away from sin. Then Imam Ghazali says, قال شيخنا رحمه الله في حد التوبة إنه ترك اختيار ذنب سبق مثله عنه منزلة لا صورة تعظيما لله تعالى وحذرا من سخطه. Regarding the boundaries and required level of repentance, our master said, repentance is to avoid a sin the like of which you committed before. And it was a great sin, not in its appearance, but in its essence. In essence. Thus, repentance is to glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala most high and to avoid his wrath. There are four conditions for repentance. فلها إذن أربع شرائط إحداها ترك اختيار الذنب. أبو فادي. ترك اختيار الذنب وهو أن يوطن قلبه ويجرد عزمه على أنه لا يعود إلى الذنب ألبتة. فأما إن ترك الذنب وفي نفسه أنه ربما يعود إليه أو لا يعزم على ذلك بل يتردد فإنه ربما يقع له العود، فإنه ممتنع عن الذنب غير تائب عنه. The first of these are four conditions for repentance is to reconcile one's heart and make a firm commitment not to commit sins. If one abstains from sin but entertains the idea that he may go back to it. Or if he does not intend to go back to sin, but finds himself wavering between staying away from sin, and there is a weakness in his heart, her heart. He may in fact fall again into sin. In such a case, he has simply stopped committing sins temporarily and cannot be considered a repentant. I would say one of the conditions to make sure that your repentance is wholesome, pure, inshallah. Stay away from the company, the context, which drives you to commit that sin. Meaning, if it's a friend, then he or she is not really a friend. Never say, I'm strong enough to be in that company. Never say, I'm strong enough. يقولون في العربية صاحب ساحب صاحب ساحب والمرء على دين خليله فانظر من خالد. That proverb in Arabic means that your friend, of course friend here is in bracket, will drag you, especially if you have a weak personality. خصيصا لمن شخصيته ايش؟ ضعيفة. والشيطان شاطر مثل ما نقول احنا. Aided by Satan, that company or that context could basically push you, drive you to commit sin in the first place or to return to committing sins. والثانية number two, أن يتوب من ذنب قد سبق عنه مثله إذ لو لم يسبق عنه مثله لكان متقيا غير تائب بل ابتعد عن الذنوب فهو تقي اتقى. ألا ترى أنه يصح القول بأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان متقيا عن الكفر ولا يصح القول بأنه كان تائبا عن الكفر إذ لم يسبق عنه كفر بحال وأن عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه كان تائبا عن الكفر لما سبق عنه ذلك. The second condition is that repentance is applied only if a man has already committed that sin. If he did not commit that sin already, there is no need for repentance, because in such a case, he is a righteous and God-fearing, God-conscientious, if you will, God-fearing man and not a repentant. Do you not see that? Whereas it is appropriate to say that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was purified from infidelity, from kufr really, from disbelief, it is inappropriate to say that he was a repentant from infidelity, because he was never an unbeliever. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was never an unbeliever. However, one can say that Umar ibn al-Khattab, the second caliph, and he was described that the Prophet by the Prophet وَأَشَدُّهُمْ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ عُمَر رضي الله عنه. He was the strongest amongst the companions in terms of his faith. Nevertheless, he had a phase in which he was an unbeliever. However, one can see that Umar, may God be pleased with him, was repentant from disbelief because previously he was a non-believer. Subhanallah. We can use the story of Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab to indicate that change is possible. Many people say, this is the way I am. I cannot change. No, you can. You can. بعض الناس يقول أنا ما أقدرش أغير أبدو غير. هيك أنا. You can change. انظر. Just look at سيدنا عمر بن الخطاب. Very. رضي الله عنه. Very strong personality. Very, very, very strong personality. The only one to migrate from Mecca to Medina in broad daylight. He who once, he said, he addressed his people. من أراد أن تثكله أمه فليتبعني إلى بطن هذا الوادي. He who ever wants his mother to weep for him. He should follow me to the valley in broad daylight. I love the personality of Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab, radiallahu anhu. Such a beautiful personality, subhanallah. But the Muslim should be a combination. Remember that Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, Sayyidina Umar, they were raised as children, as youngsters. That's a different story. I'm talking about after Islam. Their personalities were modified by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They graduated from the school of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We can change. Don't say, now that I am old. No. Every day is a day for change, positive change. Number three. قال الإمام الغزالي رحمه الله والثالثة الذي سبق يكون مثل ما يترك اختياره في المنزلة والدرجة لا في الصورة. ألا ترى أن الشيخ الهرم الفانية الذي قد سبق منه الزنا وقطع الطريق إذا أراد أن يتوب عن ذلك تمكنه التوبة لا محالة إذ لم يغلق عنه بابها ولا يمكنه ترك اختيار الزنا وقطع الطريق إذ هو لا يقدر الساعة على فعل ذلك فلا يقدر على تركه فلا يصح وصفه بأنه تارك له ممتنع عنه وهو عاجز عنه غير متمكن منه لكنه يقدر على ما هو مثل الزنا وقطع الطريق في المنزلة والدرجة كالقذف يعني قذف المحصنات والغيبة والنميمة والغيبة والنميمة إذ جميع ذلك معاصٍ وإن كان الإثم تفاوت في كل واحدة بقدرها.
التوبة في مكاننا وأنت قوي.
صحيح. This is. إن شاء الله tomorrow we will start with this. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك. نشهد أن نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Thank you.